Sunday newspaper of the Times. Inside that newspaper is a little magazine, The Parade. I like looking at that every week. And one of the articles that is in there every week is called Ask Marilyn. Marilyn is, I think her claim of fame is that she holds the Guinness World Record for the highest IQ. So she's had this column for many years. People write in asking questions that need a person with a high IQ. If you looked at this today, it's some sort of mathematic thing I didn't understand. But a few years ago, somebody wrote in and asked a question that piqued my interest. The questioner asked her, "What is the purpose of life?" Now, he added his own opinion to it. I think it was a he, if I remember. That he felt that the purpose of life is to obtain happiness and fulfillment by whatever means necessary. And that's a typical response, if not secular response. But Marilyn, she was very clever, if not wise, in answering this, because she didn't answer it directly. She answered it indirectly. She went something like this. If there is an intelligent creator, and that intelligent creator created the universe with meaning and purpose, then there is purpose. There is a purpose to life, but that purpose is determined by God, by that creator. If there is not an intelligent creator, and the universe was created by chance, then there is no purpose, no ultimate purpose. Now, I remembered that because I thought that was a very clever way of answering it. I don't know if she had a faith life or not, but if there is a God, then we have purpose in life. If there is no God, or we live our lives as if there is no God, then there is no purpose. But the good news is, and why we are here, is because we do believe that there is a God. And in believing now, we have a sense of purpose and meaning and reason to life. That's good news. But you know, sometimes we are overwhelmed by a spiritual disorder that I sometimes call only-itis. It affects our faith and our hope and our love, which St. Paul speaks of in the second reading. It decimates it. And we hear about it in our readings today, this spiritual disorder that I like to call only-itis. In our first reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah, God calls Jeremiah to be a prophet to the nations. Now we hear verses 4 and 5. We don't hear verse 6. Verse 6 is Jeremiah's response. "I don't know how to speak. I'm only a boy." In the gospel, we have our first recorded incident where Jesus preaches among his own people in his hometown. Apparently, he said something that they didn't like. And what was their response? Now, I'm paraphrasing. "Isn't this only Jesus? Isn't he only a carpenter? Only Joseph's son?" And we see this spiritual disorder of only-itis throughout the scriptures. Moses, when he was called by God to lead the people, the Hebrew people, out of the bondages of Egypt, he said to God, "I'm only a shepherd. I don't know how to speak." When David wanted to fight fight Goliath, that massive man that they call a giant, Philistine soldier. King Saul said to David, you can't fight him. You're only a youth. And you remember that passage in the gospel where Jesus told his disciples to feed the multitude of people? What did they say? How can we feed all these people when we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish? What do we say? How are we affected by this spiritual disorder of onlyitis? You ever said, I'm only human. I'm only one person. I can only do so much. I see a few smiles out there. You know, just think about that. Only human. You know what the scriptures say about the dignity of being human? The psalmist says that we humans are made little less than the angels. Little less than the angels. St. Paul speaks in his letter to the Ephesians that we humans are God's handiwork, God's masterpiece. St. Paul speaks further in his letter to the Philippians when he said God humbled himself and became human, like us in all things but sin. There is the dignity. There is what it means to only be human. And we forget that when God calls, it's not that we are only, it comes from the one and only God Himself, who chooses us as His one and only person who can live out that faith, to stand up for that faith in a very unique way that only we can do. God calls you. Rather than saying, I'm only, say, I'm the one. Because God calls you. However great or small. However old or young. However important or insignificant you may think you are. Some years back, I was called, had an emergency call. I had to go to the hospital. But this was unusual. I had to go to the neonatal unit. I knew this was pretty serious. I went there, and the nurse spoke to me, gave me an update of what was happening. I met with the parents. Their child had been severely premature. They asked if I would baptize the child. I said, of course. We had to put on our gowns and our masks and our gloves. We went into the neonatal nursery. All of these incubators. Finally came to the incubator where their child was, and what struck me first was how small the child was, no bigger than my palm of my hand. The child had a little ski cap on, the heavy one, had it looked like a sleeping mask over its eyes. It had these wires and tubes that were touching or in this little fragile body. There was a kind of a blue light that was strangely therapeutic. And there were holes, 2 holes on each side of the incubator, so that you could put your hands in there. The parents were on the other side, and because the child was so small, they only used one finger to caress the head or touch the hand. There was a little eyedropper these good and dedicated nurses had been through the scenario before. One of the other nurses stayed with us as a proxy. So I put my hand in and I picked up that little eyedropper, and ever so slightly I squeezed that rubber portion and I said, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. There were no hymns sung. There were no sermons preached. There was no liturgical vestments worn. But that moment was just as holy, just as meaningful, had just as much purpose and reason that any time I would do baptisms here in this church at that point. And I was reminded of something afterwards from St. Therese of Lisieux. If you ever read her autobiography, she begins by sharing an analogy of God's garden. She spoke of the brave souls being like the white lilies or the splendor of the roses. But the beauty of that garden also includes not just those, but also the simple violets and the little daisies as well. And that these little ones are also just as important. And that God bends down to gaze upon them and loves them just as much. You know, when I look at you, I see God's garden. That child was only a few hours old, but that child had meaning and purpose and reason for life. Because I was a child of God. You are children of God. And God calls you. Because you have meaning and purpose and reason for life, however small, however great, however important or insignificant you may be, God gazes upon you and calls you. What does God say to Jeremiah? Before I formed you